Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Lost Notebook of Édouard Manet, a novel by Maureen Gibbon, narrated by Graham Halstead. Faire vrai, laisser dire. Édouard Manet. The notebook is real. Monsieur Manet gave it to me. A few weeks before he died, he bade me take it. I first met him over my ironing board when I cleaned some wax from his coat. He and Marie were at a fete, some big do for Bastille Day, and he had gotten candle wax on the tails of his coat. It was nothing to remove. I pressed the cloth between some clean rags, and the heat of the iron drew the wax right out. But he thought I was so skilled. "Ah, Elisa," he said, "you have saved me." I laughed at his silliness, but it was nice all the same. Nice to be noticed. When he got so sick, Marie sent me often to see him. I brought candy sometimes, but mostly flowers. Some days I stopped by on my own and took a sprig of whatever I found growing. Tansy, mullein, mallow, snapdragon, even thistle. He loved those common flowers too. The weeds. One day I brought to him a dead bumblebee I found on the ground, a furry bumblebee with see-through wings. He got so quiet when I put it on his palm, and he studied it for such a long time that I didn't know what to think. Then he said, "Gone, but still glittering." He saw the beauty of it, and that made me glad I brought it. I tried to keep everything just as he gave it to me. As you know, I cannot read well, but I still felt as though I could hear Monsieur's voice when I saw the pages, and anyone can understand the little drawings. So yes, I did look through all of it, many times. I admit that. He was my friend, and he trusted me. Write it down that way. Elisa Saucy, lady's maid to Marie Laurent, as told to her niece, Mademoiselle Amy Saucy, in 1912. Paris, April 30th, 1880. They were just words, sounds in the air, said to make a point, but with no malice intended. They came from the mouth of an old friend, someone I have known all my life, or nearly, since we were boys. Now he is graying, and so am I. I told him I would consider the idea, but I did not mean it. And yet, here I am, writing in these pages, just as he suggested I might, after all my protests. So why do his words stick with me? Did they strike harder than I let on, than I realized? Yes, and yes. You cannot paint everything. That was what he told me. Of course, it only stands to reason. Logic. One picks and chooses how to spend time. And yet it meant more to me. I can almost believe he said it in consolation because he knows I am going to Materne's clinic in Bellevue. He knows the days will be long and enervating, the results questionable. I believe he meant there are other worthy tasks I might undertake. He kept using the word legacy. But you cannot tell people what to think. I found that out in 67 when I wrote my little catalogue for the show that no one attended, a manifesto that no one read. People make of you what they will. They compare you to others or to what they want you to be. So I told Tonin what I always say. My work is the only legacy. That was when he said it. You cannot paint everything. I felt as caught out as I did that day on Rue Amsterdam, when the lightning pain came on me so suddenly and so fiercely I could not do anything except fall. You cannot paint everything. The kind of thing only an old friend can say, dare say. Or maybe I have it all wrong. Perhaps Thomas said it not because he dared, but because he knows what I have been trying to hide. He said those words looking directly at me, as if to say, I have deciphered you. He knows me, just as I know him. When I painted his portrait this winter, I painted him as an aging Christ going to see Mary Magdalene. Not the young man who seeks to preserve his purity and mission, but the very human one who knows one must take his consolation as he finds it in this world. Only in this world. As we once promised each other we would, my old friend spoke the truth to me. His words were true, and that is why I cannot let them go. I cannot paint everything, because I no longer have the time. Bellevue, May 11, 1880. We have come to our rented house with our pots and pans and everyone in tow, Suzanne, my mother, Léon, and me. Even S's black kitten made the journey. He traveled in a basket, the lid woven shut with ribbon. The first thing Léon did was wrestle an extra table and small bed into this back room overlooking the garden, which is to be my retreat, my library, my studio. So here I sit, like a pasha, watching the unpacking, weighing in. But when Léon asked where I wanted the crates of painting supplies and the easel, I lifted my chin to the corner of the room. That is as much interest as I have in any of it right now. How much simpler if I were staying in an apartment on the clinic grounds as I did last year. But things are different now, as everyone from Cirde on down has told me. As if I did not know. As I write, S's new kitten sits inside the doorway. He watches all the activity, but if anything alarms him, he runs back to hide beneath my chair. I find it comical. Until today, he was afraid of me. But in a new place with so much going on, he has decided I am not so bad. I can see him making his calculations as he dashes back. At least the monster with the stiff walk is familiar, he tells himself. Bellevue, May 12, 1880. Are you ready for the waterfall, monsieur? Monsieur Victor asked this morning when I showed up in the tiled room, as if he had seen me just the day before instead of 6 months ago. But that is his joke, at least one of them. All the attendants have such comments, and each man employs his repertoire variably. Last fall the familiarity offended me, but now I see it is necessary. If the treatment were once and done, that would be one thing, but day in and day out, and for the second time in under a year, there is no chance at pretense. You cannot come slapping into the room, strip down, and then have a man shoot cold water at your legs, alternating it with massage and slaps and jiggling, and not become familiar. Let us hope I don't drown in today's waterfall, I said as I sat myself on his Spartan metal chair. No, no, it is a fine day, monsieur. Just sit here and enjoy my chaise longue. He had turned on the water by then and began to point the hose at my feet and ankles. Then there was no need to talk. Once the hydropathic treatment begins, the water speaks for us. What none of the attendants ever ask is how I am. I think the powers in charge must tell them not to. If I volunteer the information, Monsieur Victor greets it with enthusiasm or commiseration, whatever is fitting. But he never inquires. Because, of course, the truth is all too clear. If we felt at all well, we would none of us patients be here. Instead, we limp and slap our way into waterfalls and sylvan pools, where we meet with water sprites and mermaids, joking all the while. Dr. Materne has me on a 3-times-a-day regimen, water hose and pummeling in the morning and evening, swimming in the afternoon. And while Monsieur Victor and the other attendants are all fine people, all fine men, they are nothing like the women in Dr. Benibard's clinic in Paris. When Monsieur Victor and the others lay their hands on me, I can pretend no illusion of a pleasurable massage as I did with the Benibardeuse. The muscles of my legs and back are pinched and slapped, and then rubbed vigorously between rough palms. It is a kind of torture, but it is a torture I signed up for, that I show up for each day, and where I greet my torturers by name. When I am not receiving hydropathy, I take short walks, eat, rest, seek the sun when it shines. I live like a mollusk, but it will all be worth it to be healthy again. Bellevue, May 13, 1880. Up early this morning, I wanted to see the beds of peonies at the foot of the garden before the full sun of the day. But when I stepped onto the second of the paving stones, the lightning pains in my left leg chose just that moment to increase. So I stood there, afraid to move forward or back, willing my legs to hold me. The kitchen girl must have looked out and seen my predicament, because in a moment she was beside me with one of the old deal chairs from the hallway. After I sat in it, heavily, she stood beside me, talking. About Mademoiselle Embers, how kind she is, and how much she likes working for her. About the house and the garden, about her family in the countryside. She chattered long enough for me to collect myself, and when I was able, I stood. Coming back inside, I leaned too much on her. When I apologized, she patted my arm.
"I am a farm girl, monsieur," she said. "Sturdy."
Why are people like that so kind? It is not just that one pays them. Many people are paid, but not all are kind. The payment some receive for their work makes them defensive, while others in their hunger turn clever and cruel. What would the world be if people like Reine, for that is the kitchen girl's incomparable name, Reine Piouli, were in power? To live under such a reign. Bellevue, May 14th, 1880. In Paris, the kitten's name was Jacques, but out here he is Jicky. He sleeps now in a corner of my room, curled in his basket. Yet how he fought to be free of the thing on the way out here, biting at the ribbon the whole time and trying to work his paws between the lid and the basket itself. Now his prison has become a safe nook. The dreaded basket belongs to him and him alone, so he has decided to love it. Bellevue, May 15th, 1880. Mademoiselle Piouli brought a chair down to the foot of the garden and then walked down with me. She placed the chair in among the bushes so I can lean forward easily to sketch. As I was settling myself, she told me that once, when she was a girl, she peeled open a green peony bud. "I thought the color the flower would be was hidden inside, like a bead. When I saw that the inside was milky green, I felt so bad. I hid the bud beneath the bush so my mother wouldn't find it." As she spoke, she held one of the peony buds between her index and middle fingers and ran her thumb over the green sphere. If I were to paint her, I would paint her exactly that way, staring down at the bud as she caressed it with her thumb and its rough nail. After she left me to sit and rest, I did the thing I wanted to do since seeing the peonies. I pressed my face to the flowers. The petals were impossibly soft, softer than silk or a woman's skin against my lips, and they were still moist with dew this morning. Different varieties flower in the beds, but my favorite is a dense white bloom with several crimson petals at the throat. It smells as fragrant as a rose. But why even make that comparison? Something always loses in such comparisons, or becomes less than it is. The peony smells as fragrant as a peony. The trick is always to be in love. Victorine told me that years ago. Not just in love with a person, but with things. With flowers, or colors, or cats in windows, with anything you see every day. So I will be in love with peonies in the peony kingdom at the foot of the garden. Bellevue, May 16th, 1880. I was born on the 23rd of January, 1832, in Paris. My father did not approve of my desire to paint, but I did so anyway, studying first with couture.
My uncle Edmund introduced me to art, taking me to museums in the city, where we walked for hours. What is the beginning, anyway? The true beginning? Did it start in those rooms beside my uncle, looking and watching, or was something in me from even before? I remember a blue book of poems that belonged to my mother, whose color bewitched me. I remember always trying to draw a horse, but it would never come right, looking like a misshapen dog, or worse. That was why the carnets of my uncle, filled with sketches that seemed so accurate and filled with life, mesmerized me. That he could look at a house or a tree or a bowl of fruit and reproduce it on paper. That seemed like a miracle to me when I was small. His carnets were the only books I truly wanted to read. Then, when I was old enough, I spent Thursdays or Sundays with him, walking through painting-filled rooms, together much of the time, talking mostly, but at other times in companionable silence. Other days I would go off in search of whatever caught my fancy when I was 10 and 11 and 12. If we separated, and if he did not come to find me first, I could almost always discover him with his favorites, as he called them. Murillo's dejected little beggar, or Rembrandt's woman with her shining pearls. If I teased him about either, he would have a reply ready. She has kind eyes. I like her patient mouth. We are all beggars in some way. Or simply, I am allowed my loves. He said these things from the side of his mouth, loud enough only for me to hear. The day he got us into La Casa's rooms, it was I who had to tear him from Ribera's dwarf. He would have gone on studying it, oblivious of all around him. When we got outside, my uncle was silent for a long time, and then shook his head. A man's face on a child's body, he said. Not one of Goya's idiots, either. There was intelligence in that face, and joy. When have you seen joy like that? A smile alone with those nubs of teeth could break your heart. What had he seen in the dwarf's face and mouth that I had not? I looked at my uncle as he spoke that day in the street, and I saw in his face what I always saw there, a slight smile, but also something sad in the wrinkling around his eyes. It was a look I never saw on my father's face. I think it was that day I understood you either have a kindness of spirit or you do not. It is exhaled with one's breath or it is not. My uncle was kind in the way that my mother was, and in a way that my father was not capable of, even after all his suffering. Maybe Tona had it right. Not about the idea of legacy or what I hope to leave. I mean, he convinced me about this endeavor, this notebook of thoughts, this record of days. I have not taken this kind of care in thinking about my uncle in years. I will try to say here in these pages what I cannot paint. After all, I must have something to do with myself. Bellevue, May 17, 1880. Today, to distract myself from the ice picks in my skin, I thought about the lewdest things I could. The brunette who hummed when she took me in her mouth. The black-haired beauty whose thighs were covered with downy fur. The society woman who anointed her ass with gardenia oil, so that if I took her from behind, I came away smelling of that creamy flower. Bellevue, May 18, 1880. I thought I would paint out in the garden. The small drawings I have been making in this notebook made me think it might be pleasant. So I had Reine Pioli carry out my chair and then a small easel. I took out the box for plein air work. We got everything set up. I arranged my supplies and my cane, and then I sat there. It could have been that I wanted simply to enjoy the pleasant afternoon, that I was tired from the morning's hydropathy sessions. Perhaps it embarrassed me more than I was willing to admit, having a young woman carry my things for me. I am not sure. All I know is that I did not have it in me to paint. I saw flowers I could have painted, shadows and angles and colors, but it was enough to see them. to notice them and think about them. Surely it must be enough just to sit and watch sometimes. Bellevue, May 19th, 1880. I wrote again to Isabelle Le Monnier this morning, even though she has not replied to my last letter. Each time pride tells me not to write again, and each time I disobey. During the time it takes me to write to her, I am diverted. I become the person I pretend to be on the page. In the days that I wait for her reply, I am hopeful, on edge in a pleasant way. I look forward to the mail arriving without seeming too obvious about it. I let myself daydream and create fantasies. When too much time passes without response, I grow resentful. I find myself making resolutions, declarations. Then I let myself forget my disappointment so I can craft a new note upon which I may place fresh hope so the cycle can begin again. Bellevue, May 20th, 1880. Émilie Ambre, from whom we are renting, said the dense white peonies with crimson at the heart are called festiva maxima. They are like a woman who must have the fullest skirt at the dance. If I do nothing else when Reine Piolet nestles my chair among the peony bushes, I sit and admire the white balms. I bury my face in their petals and inhale for minutes at a time, no longer caring who sees me. Bellevue, May 21st, 1880. This morning I lay in bed, half sleeping, when I heard sounds in the back garden. Groggily, I went to the window, and that was where I saw Reine Piolet standing at the back gate with a young boy who had a crow sitting on his head. It took a moment for my eyes to make sense of what I was seeing, and then my mind woke fully and in an instant. I was still tucking my nightshirt into my pants when I got to the back door and opened it, at which point Mademoiselle Piolet and the boy turned to look at the noise, and the crow lifted off and flew into the trees in the lane behind the house. "I am sorry we woke you, Monsieur Manet," Mademoiselle Piolet said, walking quickly toward me and glancing back at the boy. "It's only he wanted to walk along with me this morning, and his pet comes everywhere with him." "Take me down to the peonies and tell me," I said. So she walked me down to the peony beds, got me seated, and told me the entire story. The boy is Reine Piolet's brother, Jean, who is 8 years old and who has raised the crow since he found it on the ground last year. At first, the baby crow had blue eyes and a pink mouth, and they fed it bread and milk and cut up worms. When it was young, it lived in an old hat of their father's, even after it grew its feathers and could get around. The bird was very bad at flying for a long time because it had no one to teach it except Jean, but somehow it learned anyway. "Now she can fly away whenever she likes, monsieur. I wouldn't keep her against her will," the boy said, looking down at the ground. "Only she likes to stay with you, doesn't she, Jean?" Mademoiselle Piolet asked. "You spend most of your day together." The boy nodded solemnly. "And have you trained your crow to do some tricks?" I asked, making my voice light and easy. "She will come when I call." "Most of the time," Ren said, taking the boy's hand and jiggling it a bit. "Isn't that so?" Again the boy nodded, still looking down at the ground. Then he looked up to the tree where the bird had flown. "Do you want to try to call her?" Ren asked. The boy ventured a glance at me, then a quick glance. "I know she might not come because I am here," I said, "but it cannot hurt to try." A quick nod and moment to think, and then the boy turned to the trees. He pursed his lips and made his whistle, two notes repeated several times, the last one a long, looping sound. And after a tiny interval, we heard a gruff caw. The boy again whistled, the same notes with the loop at the end, and after that second call, the crow came out from its hiding spot in the branches. It flew to a neighboring tree where it could better see us. After giving the bird a moment to watch us as we all stayed perfectly still, This petit genou whistled a third time, and the crow glided down to the ground, not 20 feet away from us. The boy looked back at me with great happiness then. The three of us watched as the bird strutted in the grass, back and forth, mostly intent on picking at things, but also turning to look at the boy, and a couple of times, seemingly at me. And I did not know what was greater in me, the desire to watch the bird with its black plumage that shone green sometimes and sometimes purple, or to watch the boy's face, which was also shining.
"She does not trust you yet, monsieur, but she does a little, or else she would not be here at all," he told me then, never taking his eyes off his crow.
He and I no doubt would have gone on happily watching the crow go about its crow business, but in a little while Mademoiselle Puley said, very gently,
"Mother will be missing you, Genoux, and I must work. Say goodbye and sorry to Monsieur Manet, whom you woke."
"Je suis désolé, monsieur."
"On the contrary, Monsieur Puley, thank you for introducing me to your friend," I said. I could tell from the funny face he made at his sister that I both confused and delighted him. The boy hugged his sister goodbye, and then she and I watched as he ran to the gate and as the crow flapped up into the air to follow him. That was the last image my mind filed away, a boy running and a crow flying just above him. Bellevue, May 22, 1880. A white spider with a pink stripe on its belly sat on the peonies today. How can a spider match a flower so precisely? Bellevue, May 24, 1880. Emilie Ombre sent over a piano from her manor for S. It is a tight squeeze in the sitting room now, but no matter. The amount of joy the instrument brings is worth having one less chair and table. S. must be happy, because she has been playing Haydn for me instead of her Schumann and Wagner. The opening of Sonata No. 33 always washes over me like a wave, making me remember mistakes I have made. Yet it does so in such a way that one sees the inevitability of them, and they become bearable to think about. I was bold once upon a time. Bellevue, May 25th, 1880. It turns out that S's kitten is not a black kitten at all. He is a black kitten with hints of brown and maroon in his fur. How did I fail to see this before? Bellevue, May 26th, 1880. This morning I heard crying coming from the women's stalls, and I am quite sure it was La Dame L. When I looked at Monsieur Victor, his face revealed nothing. They give cold showers to the belly for digestive maladies, so what must they do for women's troubles? All is to be suffered in this place where we willingly submit to our torturers. Bellevue, May 27th, 1880. Goddess of the red hair and cleft chin. I have not seen her for years, and now I cannot stop thinking of her. Is it because I wrote her name in here the other day? Victrine, the way she used to say it. Hours go by when I remember not only her and time spent with her, but also painting her, La Ligne du Nu. When I saw her last, for Gare Saint-Lazare, she was a woman, not the girl I knew. Yet when we embraced, it all came back. She must have felt it, too, because for a moment she kissed me the way she always had, and when we parted, she told me, "You taste the same." What I want now is what all old men want, to be young again. What I want is what all sick people want, to have my body back. Not memories of things, but a woman's body before me on a bed, frank and open. Bellevue, May 30th, 1880. When I stopped among the peonies this morning, I saw how many petals they had dropped and how some of the flowers' edges were curling and yellowing. Seeing them made me think of poor Jeanne Duval, Baudelaire's mistress. She insisted on her impossible white crinolines for her portrait, even though she had difficulty walking, even though the ruffles were tatty, even though her foot had begun faintly to rot. "I revel in the smell," B told me when I started the thing. "If one truly loves a woman, one loves her stench as well." That was before he decided he hated the way I painted her. He believed I had not done justice to her, had purposely made her look imbecilic. But I painted her face as best I could in the time she gave me. She was beginning to go blind, and now I think even sitting there with her foot up on an ottoman was an agony. That was the look I saw in her face. Not arrogance, as I thought at the time, nor the impersonal mask of a doll. Just a woman in pain. Bellevue, June 2nd, 1880. Jean Piolet came this morning. His crow is called Lucette. She still will not fly to him in my presence, but she came much closer than she did the other week. Her eyes a glossy black bead, and she has feathers that grow down over her beak. Jeannot and I talked for 20 minutes about her habits and practices before he got chased back home so he could help his mother in the garden. Bellevue, June 4th, 1880. When I sat down to write to Marie today, I thought I would put a shine on things, but when I picked up my pen, I could not help but write, "Marie, I am doing penance here as never before, but what I go through here is much worse than what the old priests used to give. I would say Hail Marys and all the Stations of the Cross each day if it meant anything." And even though I did not write any more about my malady, it was a relief to say that much, to say something genuine. I do not know what it is about Marie, but I do not mind if she knows I am suffering. I think it is her own vitality, her own spirit. One does not feel as if one is weighing her down. Her sympathy never cloys, and there is no need to keep up a brave front as one does with a man, as I do even with Tonin. Do I feel love for her because she never broke my heart and I never broke hers? Or because she never demanded anything of me, except pleasure? The first time I made love to her, she commanded me, "Now you wait. You wait for me." And so it was every time after. Maybe it is Marie's own queer trajectory in life. Her mother thought the best way to give her daughter a solid start in life was to sell off her virginity to her employer, an old army general. Marie used the annuity a year later when she was 16 to leave home and become an actress in Paris. She also began acquiring a vast knowledge of people and places, high and low, and where the wheel of fortune may stop. You do not mind when someone like that knows you or knows about your pain, because they have seen so much. In any case, there is no way I can pretend with Marie. I had to ask her to handle the business with Barreuil, who is her friend, and to do it quickly. I need money desperately, and those cafe paintings will bring a bit of cash. If confiding my dire financial state is not proof of real intimacy between us, I do not know what is. Bellevue, June 7th, 1880. Last night I slept heavily for the first time since we came here. Slept with closed fists, as they say. Perhaps it was exhaustion or some altered state. Because even when I did wake to piss, it was only enough to pull the chamber pot between my legs as I sat on the edge of the bed, and then I went immediately back to sleep again. Almost as if my cock and bladder woke and not my mind or thoughts. What does it mean that the pain has stopped? I do not want to remember it or even think about it too heavily or in any great depth, since imagining can bring feeling. Will I live in fear of my own thoughts now, for dread of pain returning? I do not believe so. If anything, I have learned that the worst pain never comes when I think it will, and never returns in the exact same way. You go to bed with one pain and wake up with another. It wears as many disguises as a masker at a ball.
Bellevue, June 10th, 1880. I am still shaking a bit as I write this. I have been feeling so much stronger that this afternoon Léon and I set out to walk to the river. We'd only gone a little way when dragonflies, dozens at first, then hundreds, began to fly beside us. But even that is not accurate. The dragonflies circled us and hovered beside and above us. They were everywhere at once, moving as we moved. I mean, we walked inside their mass. We were inside some ancient, secret rite. From time to time, one would light upon us, on our shoulders or on our hair. One landed on my face, on my cheek above my beard, and it stayed there long enough for me to feel the scratching of its feet on my skin, and an almost imperceptible tick as it lifted off me and flew on. I might have been startled, but I was too intent on feeling the sensation of the dragonfly's thread-like feet to be startled. When I looked at Léon, I could see the same expression on his face as I imagined was on my own, and it took me a moment to recognize what I was seeing in his face, to know it by its name. Awe. We walked slowly, looking up and around us, utterly silent. There was a density to the dragonflies because of their number, but it was not density in its usual sense because of the vastness of the sky and because the dragonflies themselves were almost weightless and ever shifting in the light. Their slender forms, dark and glinting by turns, went up and up into the blue sky until they were not discernible. Those flying needles stayed with us as we walked along the path. I mean, they accompanied us, the whole mass moving as we moved. As time passed, and we were inside the circling and the darting and the flashing.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.